So we're going to close the series today, Thy Will Be Done. When it comes to God's will, we have two options: my way or God's way. We can spend our entire life doing things our way, and we may even get the desired result at the end of your journey. You can even sing that song, Frank Sinatra, I Did It My Way. Now the end is near, so we face the final curtain, and that he said, I did it my way. So we can spend our time doing things our way or God's way. Like I mentioned on my first message, first Sunday of this month, not too many pray the prayer, let your will be done. I asked you the question when I was in the emergency room, did you pray for me? And everybody, yes, we prayed for you. And I said, did you pray for me that God's will be done? And everybody said, no. I wonder why. Not too many people pray that way. Lord, just let your will be done. Especially in that situation when, you know, you're in the ER, you're in the emergency room, pick up by the ambulance, and nobody will pray, let your will be done. We want to make sure that we ask the right thing and that we'll get what we want to happen. So we can even spend our time or gathering all the promises we can find in the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, everything in between. We normally look for the verses that says, like for example, let your request be made known. So we pretty much gather all the promises in the Bible and tell God, Lord, this is what it is. This is how we want it. This is where you promise that you're going to do it. So that's where we remind God that, you, Lord, you promise that you will do this. But that's just one option when it comes to prayer. There is another option that I think is the most powerful option, and that is, let your will be done. So when Jesus prayed in Luke chapter 22, verse 42, when Jesus prayed that night when he was arrested, he said, Father, if you are willing, let this cup pass over me. In other words, Jesus prayed, Father, if it's your will, I don't want to go through the painful death on the cross. I said, nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. So his first option was, he has a specific request that he will not go through the suffering and the death on the cross, because it's painful. Nobody wants to go through some pain, especially if it is one of the most excruciating, one of the most painful way to die. Nobody wants that. That's why we pray a specific prayer. But the second option you have is to allow God's plan to take its course, and that is to go through the painful process of dying on the cross. That's the second option. Jesus prayed and said, "Let your will be done." Which one would you choose? The easy way or the hard way? That's up to us. For the last two Sundays, we've learned a couple of responses to God's will from two different people. First, from a young girl named Mary. Stephanie preached about that. Whose life was interrupted, whose future took a different direction when she responded to God's will. And she said, "I am the Lord's servant. Let it be to me as you have said." So that's Mary's response. When the angel told her that she's going to have a baby, she's going to bear a son, and give birth to a son, Mary's response was, "I am the Lord's servant. Let it be to me just as you have said." Last Sunday, we learned about the response of Job. Job, a very rich man who lived in luxury and aware of God's plan, was stripped of everything, but in spite of the painful experience, his response was, "Naked I came, naked I will return." That's another way of saying, let God's will be done, even if I lost everything. He said, "Naked I came, naked I will return." That means being in God's will can only mean one thing. Live a life of obedience. To be in God's will is to live a life of obedience. That's what we're going to be talking about today. Obedience. Living a life of obedience could mean a total surrender to God's plan regardless of the outcome. Okay, let me repeat that. A total surrender to God's plan regardless of the outcome. Because again, we want to control the outcome. We want to be specific. We want to be precise. But living in God's will is again a total surrender to God's plan regardless of the outcome. Being in God's will could mean your own life's plan will be interrupted. It's not easy. It's a very uncomfortable situation when your life is being interrupted because we want everything to be smooth. We want to wake up every morning without problem, without no issues. We just want to go through life taking it easy. But again, to be in God's plan could mean that your life will be interrupted. Being obedient to God could mean a change of direction from your dreams and plans. You know, like you're studying to be probably a doctor. You're studying to be a doctor, but God tells you to be a missionary instead. So to be in God's plan could mean that change of direction. Being in God's will could mean different experience from what you are expecting. Okay, you have different expectation. Being in God's will, in obedience to God's will, could mean trusting God's sovereignty. God is sovereign. So let's learn some lessons about obedience today. So I'm still having the 3 points because I'm the original. 3 points. Mark changes the structure of putting a message together. first lesson that we can learn is being in God's will does not guarantee smooth sailing. Okay, let me repeat that. Being in God's will or in obedience to God's will does not guarantee a smooth sailing. When we find ourselves or even look at others who are dealing constantly with life's issues and trouble, we can easily and comfortably conclude that the person is living in disobedience to God. I mean, when you see somebody who is in trouble, whose life is not sailing smoothly, is again, we can comfortably say that that person is not living within God's will. And Jonah the prophet is the best example that we have as a person living in disobedience to God's will. We know that Jonah was called by God to preach repentance to the wicked people of Nineveh, but instead he completely disobeyed God. He ran away as far as he could. He was supposed to go east, so he go west, far away from where God wants him to be. And he had a very good reason. Jonah had a very good reason to run away or to disobey God, because the Ninevites or the Assyrians were enemies of Israel. They constantly attack Israel. So God told him to preach, but he ran away. Went to a different direction. Again, he had a very good reason. But his troubles began. We knew that he went on a boat and going to a place away from Nineveh. But then a great big storm hit him, even affecting the people around him. Then he told the ship's crew to throw him overboard. That means he wanted to die. Then he got swallowed by a fish. Big fish ended up in where? He ended up in Nineveh, where God wants him to be at the first place. So he ran away from God, away from Nineveh, but his trouble began. He started to have troubles with his life, and he just cannot have peace. So no smooth sailing for Jonah, who lived in disobedience outside of God's will. However, living within God's will does not guarantee a smooth sailing either. And so it was easy for us to say, well, he was in trouble because Jonah was in trouble because he was running away from God. He was not living in obedience to God's will. So his trouble came after the other. But living in obedience to God's will does not guarantee smooth sailing either. Just because we are living within God's will doesn't mean that everything will be fine. Last Sunday we learned about Job. And we learned that Job was a man who was blameless before the Lord. A man who lived in righteousness. And then we can conclude that Job lived a life in obedience to God's will. But his life was no smooth sailing either. It was a life filled with troubles. Storm after storm hit Job. He lost his wealth, he lost his children, and he got sick with a very painful disease. That's not supposed to happen to a person living in obedience to God. His friends concluded that Job's misfortune was a result of his disobedience. So his friends went to visit him and did a good job the very first night. He didn't say anything. And then they started opening their mouth. And they condemned Job. And they did not help Job to ease his pain. It made things worse. So sometimes it's just wise to, when somebody is in trouble or when somebody is sick, don't try to tell them that you know exactly how they're feeling, because you don't know how they feel. Just be there. Pray for them. And just put your arms around them. His three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar basically said the same thing. He said Job's suffering was a consequence of his disobedience and that he needed to repent. That's what they told him. Again, they made things worse. Because without knowing what's going on, sometimes it's best not to say anything, just be there. So for Job, who lived in complete obedience to the will of God, there was no smooth sailing. At least Jonah, we can easily say that, well, that's what he got because he's living a life of disobedience. But for Job, we can't say that. Because again, Job lived a life of obedience to the will of God. If you remember also one story that one day Jesus told the disciples, go ahead, go on the boat and go to the next, to the other side. And Jesus stayed back and was praying. While in the middle of the lake, the storm came and blew against the boat that they were in. But think of this. They only responded to what Jesus said. They were in obedience to what Jesus said. Jesus told them, go to the other side. Go ahead to the other side. And they did exactly what Jesus told them. And yet, they were hit by a storm. They struggled and was going nowhere until Jesus came and rebuked the storm. So there are times that we respond in obedience to the will or to the command of the Lord. And yet we'll find ourselves in the middle of the storm. Because again, to live in obedience to the will of God doesn't mean it's going to be a smooth sailing. Sometimes it's going to be rough. Sometimes it's going to be difficult. Sometimes it's going to be hard. But one thing for sure that we can always count, whether it's Jonah living in disobedience to God or Job was living in obedience to God, one thing we can count, and that is for sure, is that God was there directing the storms to bring them to exactly where He wants them to be. Remember Jonah? He was living in disobedience to God, so he got into a lot of trouble. There was no peace for Jonah. Job was a complete opposite. He lived in obedience to God's will, but he still suffered. But one thing again, we can be sure is that, remember, regardless what storm you are in, whether you are in a storm because of disobedience or you are in a storm because of obedience, God is there directing the storm to bring exactly Jonah to where God wants him to be, to bring Job where God wants him to be. And with the disciples' case, when they were in the storm, Jesus was there to rebuke the storm. So we can really never run away from God. Regardless of what's going on, whether you are again suffering because of disobedience or because of obedience, God is there directing the storm to bring us to exactly where God wants us to be. For the disciples' case, God or Jesus rebuked the wind. So that's the number one thing that I want us to remember. Living in obedience to God's will doesn't necessarily mean that it's a smooth sailing. Second thing that I have here is living in obedience to God's will doesn't always mean instant victory. A lot of times we think that because it is God's will, we'll have instant victory. Not at all. We're going to read a story from Judges chapter 20. We're going to read from 18 to 25. But before we read that, let me tell you about what led to this event here in Judges 20 to 18 and 25. This, in chapter 19 of Judges is the story, the story began. And let me tell you what happened first. Chapter 19, but we do not have time to read all that. So this is a story of a man who belonged to the tribe of Levi. Together with his concubine, on their way home to the land of the Levites, stopped over the land of Benjamin. And somebody was very nice enough to let them rest over in their house. When the man of Benjamin or Benjamite, the land of Benjamite, learned or knew or heard that there was a man living there or stopped over, they went over there and knocked at the door of the man and said, "Send the man out so that we could have our way with him." Reminds me of Sodom and Gomorrah. Sodom and Gomorrah, the men of Sodom and Gomorrah did the same thing. They wanted the men that Lot, what's his name? But this one here, instead of the man went out of the house. And the story is very, horrible story. I don't think it will make it in the movie. I don't know what rating this will have. But to cut the story short, the woman that was with the man ended up outside. You can read that story. And then the man of the land of Benjamin had their way with her. I mean, they raped her, violated her, and left her dead. Okay, that's the story. Left her dead. And the story turned into something more worse. So when the husband woke up in the morning and found out that his wife was dead, what he did is He cut her body into 12 pieces. It's crazy, isn't it? He cut her body into 12 pieces and then sent its pieces to the 12 tribes of Israel, including Benjamin. And when they got the news and saw the body, the 11 tribes were furious. They got so angry that they said, Benjamin must be punished for the crime they have committed. So here's the response now of the 11 tribes. We're going to read from chapter 20, verse 18 to 25. It's the Israelites, when it says the Israelites, that means the 11 tribes, went up to Bethel. Bethel simply means Beth, house, El is God, the house of the Lord. Okay, so the Israelites went up to Bethel and inquired of God. That's the very first thing that they did. They inquired of God. They did not do anything before they inquire or before they ask the Lord. So they inquired of God. They said, who of us is to go up first to fight against Benjamin? The Lord replied, Judah shall go first. Verse 19. The next morning the Israelites got up and pitched camp near Gibeah. The Israelites went up to fight the Benjamites and took up battle position against them at Gibeah. The Benjamites came up of Gibeah and cut down 22,000 Israelites on the battlefield that day. But the Israelites encouraged one another and again took up their positions where they had stationed themselves the first day. The Israelites went up and wept over the Lord until evening and they inquired of the Lord. They said, shall we go up to fight against Benjamin, our fellow Israelites? The Lord answered, go up and go up against them. Then the Israelites drew near to Benjamin the second day. So this is the second time again that they went to fight against Benjamin. The Lord answered, go up against them. Then the Israelites drew near to Benjamin the second day. This time when Benjamin came out from Gibeah to oppose them, they cut down another 18,000 Israelites, all of them armed with sword. This is a very weird story. So the 11 tribes or the Israelites gathered together and again they inquired of God. They ask the Lord. They ask the Lord's will. Lord, what is it your will? Shall we punish Benjamin for the crime that they have committed? And God said, what did God say? What did God say? Yes. Go up against them. That means the very first time that they attacked Benjamin, they were within God's will. They prayed for it. And yet when they attacked the Benjamites, they lost how many? 22,000 fighting men. What's going on here? They prayed. They asked the Lord. And then the second time, they gather again, encourage one another. And then the second time, they inquire of the Lord from morning till evening. And God said, go up against them. So they did not rush to punish the men of Benjamin for the horrific crime that they have done. The first thing that they did was inquire of God, to be sure that what they were about to do was within God's will, or to make sure that they will have victory. Yet, Second time that they did, they lost 18,000 men. 22 and 18. How much is that? 22 plus 18. I'm not good in math, so. You're not even sure. 40. That's a lot. And think of this. They were within God's will. Benjamin committed a crime. A horrible thing that they did. But yet, two times they inquired of God. And they lost 40,000 men. They were within God's will. Yet, the victory was not theirs. Being in God's will does not guarantee instant victory. But one lesson we can find here is that they never give up. They never give up. First time, they did not win. The second time, they did not win. But on the third time, they won. So not only that being in obedience to God's will does not guarantee smooth sailing, it does not guarantee instant victory. You need to fight. You will have to fight. We cannot just give up. Fight knowing that we are within God's will. Never give up. I'm asking and keep fighting. We need to be persistent. Even though we are in God's will, we need to be persistent in our prayer. Just like Jacob. Jacob was very persistent when he wrestled with God and asked God to bless him. Third thing is that being in obedience to God's will affect the future generation. Being in obedience to the will of God not only affect the present and your immediate surrounding, but it has a far-reaching effect beyond your generation and the next. Our obedience or disobedience can affect future generation. Does that only affect the present? Does that only affect your surroundings right now? But it has a far-reaching effect that will touch the generation and beyond. Genesis chapter 22, 16 to 18. This was the time when Abraham was told by God to offer Isaac. And that was not easy. You know, when we are reading the story of Abraham offering Isaac as a burnt sacrifice, we read it as, oh, that's Abraham was a faithful man. It was very easy for him. But it's not easy. Okay? But Abraham did it anyway. He did it. He went up to the mountain that was told by God, offered Isaac, and was ready to strike Isaac to offer him as a burnt offering. And because of what he did, this is what God said in Genesis chapter 22, 16 to 18. God said, I swear by myself. There's no beyond. There's no higher than God, higher than him. That's why he swore by himself. I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this, what has done this. We live in obedience to God's will. This and have not withheld your son, your own son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sands of the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me. See? The obedience of Abraham had a very far-reaching effect. Not only that the direct descendants of Abraham, the Hebrew people, who are enjoying the blessings of God, but because of what Abraham did, we too are enjoying the blessings. We are enjoying the blessings because of what Abraham did. And going back to the prayer of Jesus when he said, let your will be done. Not my will, but your will be done. What was at stake there is the salvation of mankind. So because of what Jesus did and because of what Abraham did, he lived in obedience to the will of God. The result still affects us. Many people even today are still enjoying the blessings of salvation and the blessings that God promised to Abraham. So think of this. When we obey or disobey God, it has a far-reaching effect beyond your present and your surrounding. It can affect even the future generations and beyond. That is how powerful it is. Now let me make it simple before I close. I know that the death of Jesus Christ on the cross, or Job's suffering, or Mary's giving birth to the Messiah, and Abraham's offering of his son Isaac are overwhelming. You did a giant step of obedience, something the majority of us don't experience. In other words, none of us have been asked to offer our children to the Lord, just like what Abraham was asked. None of us was told to go to the cross and die. None of us have been asked like Mary, bear a son, or the Messiah, or the Savior of the world. Those are so overwhelming. Those are big things. But I wanted to bring it to our daily experience. Okay? In what Job did and what Abraham did and what Jesus did, what Mary did, as something that we don't experience. But let me make it simple. To bring it to down to our daily experience. Let's read a story in Luke chapter 5, 1 to 6. Okay. You have that there? Okay. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. He saw at the water's edge two boats left the fishermen who were washing their nets. Now one of the boats and belonging to someone asked him to put a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Pull out into the deep water and let down the nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will let down the net. Verse 6. When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So this story is a simple case of obedience. Something that you and I can relate as we do our life daily. Again, no one was sacrificed for a burnt offering. Nobody was nailed to the cross in this story. Nobody got pregnant to of the Messiah, Savior of the world. It was a simple fisherman doing his daily routine who responded to a very simple command. It would have been a lot easier for Peter to say or to continue arguing that he tried all night and I am the expert here, you're not. It would be a lot easier for us when to say no because we are the expert of ourselves and of the things that we do. But something very simple here changed Peter's day. He was fishing all night but caught nothing. And Jesus told him, put out into the deep and water and let down the net for a catch. And Peter simply said, because you say so, I will. Because you say so, I will. Those simple words of obedience activated the power of God. From an empty net to a net full of blessings. I wonder how much blessings we miss every day by insisting that we know better or having that attitude, been there, done that. I wonder how many blessings we don't enjoy. It was very simple obedience that Peter did here. Something that we can relate to every day. Fishing was his daily thing. Fishing was the thing that he do every single day. Fishing that is something that he know inside and out. Something that we can relate to. Something that we do every single day. Maybe we wake up in the morning and we go to work. But God is talking to us. But we insist that we know better because I've done this. And I'm doing this every single day. Then I wonder how many blessings we have missed. Because we insist we're doing better. Peter simply said, because you say so, I will. It's different from what we do every day. I said earlier, we gather all the promises we can find in the Bible from Genesis to Revelation and everything in between. And remind God, tell Him exactly how we want it to be. As a matter of fact, we do pray the same thing every day, right? Amen? When we pray, when you are asked to pray for, you know, before we eat, every time I say, can you pray? And you're like, oh no, Pastor picked me to pray. And we're scared to pray. And then when we pray, We almost pray the same thing. Lord, thank you for this food. Bless. Lord, bless my day today. Guide and protect me as I drive. Maybe we should try one day and say, Lord, what is your will today? Because you say so, I will. It is a very simple prayer of obedience. He was fishing all night long and caught nothing. And because of that obedience, a very simple command, it's a very simple response. Of an empty net, a net full with blessings. Living a life of obedience means we must trust that God knows better than we are. We do. You know, when I said, and I asked you the last time, how many of you prayed for me when I was in the ER? How many of you prayed for me and said, let your will be done, Lord? And everybody said, no, we didn't pray that. Because you prayed that, heal him, Lord. So I'm still here, still standing here, preaching. Maybe if you pray that lecture will be done, Lord, I was already in heaven. I'm already enjoying. Right? I know, but we don't want that prayer because, like I said every time, everybody talks about how beautiful heaven is, it's the streets of gold and no more pain there, no more crying there, but nobody wants to go there early. But heaven is real, and we can enjoy it. But again, how many blessings we have missed because we insist that we know better instead of trusting God's plan. Again, living a life of obedience is trusting God's wisdom. God knows better. Knows His plan. He knows what's best for us. The last thing is, living a life of obedience means to acknowledge God's sovereignty. This, if you really look at deeper, the sovereignty of God, There's not much we can do because it is God's will, because of His sovereignty, what He wills, He will do. We live within the will of God. Don't forget that. The reason why we are still here and this world is still turning around, the reason that we are still breathing is because it is the will of God. So there's nothing for us to be afraid of when we pray, let your will be done, because you say so, I will. It's nothing for us to worry about, because again, we need to trust God and His sovereignty. He is sovereign. In other words, He will do what He wants to do, regardless of what we think. So live in obedience to the will of God. And again, it does not have to be so complicated. It will be as simple as something that we do every day. Because you say so, Lord, I will. Let us pray. Dear Lord, I know that there are those people in the Bible who are big heroes of faith, like Abraham, Jacob, David, Job, Mary. They all live in obedience to your will. But most of us, O Lord, don't experience those things. We are not asked to offer a son as a burnt offering. We are not like Job, who lost everything. Man who lived in luxury. He was blameless before God. And he lost everything, even though he lived within your will. None of us are like Mary. We've been asked and told that he was going to bear a son. But like Peter, O God, every day we can live a simple life of obedience to your will. Like Peter was a fisherman. His daily routine, doing his daily routine, something that he did every day. That's something that we can relate to. We can also live a life of obedience by simply saying, Lord, because you say so, I will. And that changed the day. From having an empty net to a net filled with blessings. Lord, our prayer today is that we too can live a life of obedience in a very simple way, daily. Our daily experience, we can enjoy your blessings. Let's all stand. It's the worship team. Let's just worship. Let's just worship.